Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will take evidence at stage one on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. I'd like to welcome our first panel to the meeting, who are all virtual today. Professor Fiona de Londres, Professor of Global Legal Studies, COVID Review Observatory, University of Birmingham. Anthony Smith, Chief Executive of Westminster Foundation for Democracy, and Professor Paul Hunter, Professor in Medicine, Norwich Medical School, University of East Anglia. A warm welcome and thank you for giving us your time this morning. This session will be the first of the committee's evidence sessions on the bill, and we will look at the public health measures contained in part one of the bill. We'll be taking evidence on the bill at two further meetings on the 10th and the 24th of March before we hear from the Deputy First Minister on the 31st of March. Each member will have approximately 8 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. If you'd like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we'll try and bring you in. I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak. I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much and may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of brevity. If I can just briefly just ask you to introduce yourselves to members. Can we start with Professor de Londres?
Good morning, convener and members of the committee. My name is Fiona de Londres. I'm a professor of law here in Birmingham Law School, and also I lead the COVID-19 Review Observatory, which analyses ways in which parliaments have affected oversight during the pandemic. I'm looking forward to speaking with you this morning.
Thank you very much. Anthony Smith.
Good morning, convener and members. Anthony Smith, Chief Executive of the Westminster Foundation for Democracy. I am actually a substitute for my colleague, Franklin De Vries, who was a co-author of a relevant paper, but unfortunately is ill today. So I'll do my best to fill in for his much deeper knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I just think there's a slight problem with your sound. We could hear you, but it was a bit more faint than it was from the previous witness. Can I bring in Professor Hunter?
Hello, I'm Paul Hunter. I'm a professor in medicine at the Norwich Medical School at the University of East Anglia. I'm a medical doctor specialising in medical microbiology and virology. Most of my research for the past, goodness knows how many years, has been on the spread of emerging infectious diseases, epidemics and outbreaks of infection.
Thank you very much. If I can move on to questions, and if I may start, with the great benefit of hindsight, I think we can all acknowledge that no country on this planet was prepared for COVID when it hit. And in my personal opinion, governments around the world have a moral duty to reflect over the past 2 years, learn lessons and put measures in place to ensure that we're never in the position that we found ourselves in March 2020. We know that the Prime Minister confirmed on the 21st of February that certain temporary provisions for England relating to improvements in the delivery of public services will also be made permanent via the Westminster Bills. So as we move forward to put legislation in place to keep the public safe in the future, my question to the panel is, what do you believe are the principles which underpin good quality and effective legislation for emergency situations? Can I start with Professor de Londres, please?
Thank you, convener. I think there are a couple of things that are important here. So the first thing is to ensure that the legislative framework that is put in place to enable emergency responses would itself envisage the kinds of situations of urgency and strain that both executives and parliaments find themselves under in emergency situations. And so that means trying to design in a way that balances the need for a rapid response and flexibility with the need for effective parliamentary oversight. This is more difficult maybe than it sounds, but a couple of principles that are helpful are to try to ensure that the law allows for fast and coordinated responses, that it also ensures that in those responses, human rights concerns are recognised as effective limitations on what the state may do. That means, of course, that measures should be targeted and limited, potentially in time, but also in scope to what is required in a particular situation. and that there should be no policy laundering or the use of emergency powers to address things other than the emergency in question. It's useful for measures to be limited in time, so that is the emergency measures introduced to be limited in time, but with an effective review mechanism. So not only that there would be review, but that there would be a way for that review to be meaningful and to cause change if needed, and that there would be the maximum possible transparency in decision making, and to the extent that that can be imposed through a legislative framework, that would be welcome. I'm happy to expand on any of those as they relate to the particular bill if you wish, but I think those are some principles to start with.
Thank you very much. If I can bring in Anthony Smith for the same question.
Thank you, Convener. I hope this is clearer now in the sound.
Slightly better.
Thank you. I think the points that our paper, which examined the use of sunset clauses, tried to make were that when emergency measures are introduced into legislation, there is often a provision for them to be temporary. But the way that those provisions are framed can sometimes be inadequate in a number of ways. First, those provisions can sometimes set up an expectation of renewal of the measures. So even though at the time of drafting the legislation, the debate says that these will be temporary, in some ways, the way in which they're framed makes it easier for them to be renewed without significant debate. Second, the way in which those review provisions are framed can sometimes be unclear. It has to be very clear exactly which provisions are going to be reviewed and what the mechanism of review is going to be. And third, they need to provide the type of scrutiny that is appropriate to those measures. In other words, if you look at some of the legislation in a number of countries, including the UK, a very small amount of parliamentary time is devoted to the review of the provisions before they are extended. So there are some things which need to be thought through carefully if there is an expectation that these measures are temporary. And I think the second thing that I would comment on is whether in addressing a situation like the pandemic and coronavirus, the types of emergency measures that were used and that are being made permanent in the new legislation have shifted the boundary between what is considered ordinary levels of executive power and extraordinary ones. If they have shifted that boundary, has there been full consideration of that by the Parliament in the new legislation before that step is taken? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. And can I ask the same question, which is, what do you believe are the principles which underpin good quality and effective legislation, for Professor Hunter?
I've heard it said that military planners are always planning for the previous war, not the next war. And I think that the same applies to infectious diseases. Now, whatever we do has to be flexible, because there is no guarantee that the next outbreak is going, a major pandemic, major infectious disease threat is going to be anything like what we've just lived through. So I think it has to be flexible to cope with new threats, whatever they may be, and they may not be like what we've had with COVID. But again, I think the issue as well is actually how much did our existing legislation fail us? And to a large extent, I can't speak about the Scottish legislation, but the most of the English legislation was, in terms of certainly the early parts of a pandemic, were fit for purpose, in my view. And certainly it wasn't until well into the initial pandemic that additional legislation, I think, was needed.
Thank you very much for all your answers and raising your valid points. Can I move on to Murdo Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our witnesses. I suppose that the key issue the committee has to consider in relation to this bill is, are the measures that are before us necessary and proportionate, or do they represent ministerial overreach? And we've had a lot of evidence presented to us from interested parties and from members of the public, and there's quite a strong theme that's come through these about the issue of civil liberties. And that's really what I wanted to ask you about this morning. The bill will allow Scottish ministers to impose quite substantial restrictions on people's activities, as we've seen over the last 2 years, but do that on a permanent basis. There will be particular impacts in the area of health, where individuals can be required to submit to medical treatment, can be detained in a hospital or other suitable establishment, or be forced to be put into quarantine. So can I ask you all, what is your view on this? And does the bill strike an appropriate balance between the protection of public health and respect for civil liberties? And how do you think that question of proportionality will work through in practice? Maybe start with Professor Londrist.
Thank you. I mean, I think one of the challenges with a bill of this kind, and it relates to what Mr. Smith was saying in his first response, is that, of course, you're thinking here about introducing a permanent legislative edifice within which then these responsive measures could be taken. So the questions of necessity and proportionality in substantive terms that you raise are likely to arise most urgently in respect of the individual regulations introduced under the powers within the bill. So, of course, much will depend on the modes of scrutiny of those regulations if and when they need to be introduced. But broadly speaking, within the structure that this bill proposes to introduce, I think it is worth noting that it has a number of safeguards. So it has these threshold or triggering safeguards, which you're familiar with, of course. So there has to be a public health emergency, and then the measures themselves must be proportionate or considered to be proportionate. And for more intrusive kinds of powers, such as medical examinations and so on, there's an additional safeguard that they can they must be the least intrusive method available, and so on. The bill does have safeguards built into it that I think are welcome and worth noting. But the challenge, I think, therefore, is around how regulations would be made and the extent to which Parliament will be enabled to challenge assertions of proportionality and necessity of the individual regulations. This, as you know, gets us into the territory of affirmative or made affirmative lawmaking and so on, which may arise later. But I think that that is an important consideration here. Certainly, questions of proportionality in responding to public health emergencies will have an element of judgment to them. They're not an exact science, as you know. And so that is why I think those matters of process combined with the safeguards built into this permanent edifice within the bill are particularly important to dig into at some point.
Thank you. I might come back to you on the issue of process, but can I ask the others on the panel for a view? Maybe Professor Hunter?
Yeah, I think one of the issues, I think, has come out very strongly during the COVID pandemic is who decides what is proportionality or not. And one of the, I think, main issues in my view is that we've got very different groups of individuals and individual scientists, not all of whom have actually got any prior experience of infectious disease, it must be said, but have very strong views one way or the other. And to a certain extent, some of them could be accused of maintaining those views despite the evidence, not because of the evidence. And I think, so ultimately, who makes the decision? Is it the minister, who generally won't be somebody who will have a public health background, won't have an infectious disease background? And so how is that person going to be advised? How are you going to come to a decision about what is proportional? Often in a setting where there is considerable uncertainty, as we saw certainly in 2020 about the uncertainty of the future of COVID. I mean, I think one of the things that you said about requiring people to undergo medical treatment, my understanding was that the draft bill specifically excludes that, and I think that's appropriate. We have a long history in the UK of having powers to remove patients to hospital if they pose a threat to others, and that already exists certainly in English legislation, and I believe also in Scottish legislation. It's relatively rarely implemented, but I think we do need to make sure that those sorts of restrictions are only brought in as a very last resort. Over.
Okay, thank you. And Anthony Smith.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fraser. Nothing much to add except to say that in looking at the experience of emergency legislation during COVID around the world, the key issue has been the extent to which the emergency legislation allowed real oversight and scrutiny of the provisions by the legislature, and too often it didn't. And in a situation in which the knowledge and understanding of what is required is changing over time, it has often been felt to be even more important that Parliament builds into the legislation the opportunity to really understand and review the provisions on a regular basis. Thank you.
Right. I understand Professor de Londres wants to come back in.
Yeah, if I could just add two things, just to note, I mean, the bill does include a power to require someone to submit to medical examination, but that is at the highest threshold of being able to be triggered. So not only does there have to be a public health emergency, but the measure in question must be made in response to a serious and imminent threat to public health, and then it must also be proportionate. So it has multiple levels of safeguard, reflecting its more invasive nature. It's a special restriction or requirement, and I think that that's important to note. And secondly, just to come back to this point on proportionality, I think one thing that the Scottish Parliament, of course, is very well aware of and extremely good at doing is to dig down into the distinctions between this idea of something being proportionate from a scientific perspective and something being proportionate where proportionality is understood as a test of public law and human rights law. So, of course, these questions of whether a measure is rationally connected to the outcome and the likelihood of its success in achieving that outcome are issues on which a minister would need to be advised by scientists. But the ultimate question of balancing, that fundamental proportionality question, is not answerable by scientific method, as you know. It is a matter of judgment, weighing all the different costs, including human rights costs, up against the likelihood of success and whether the measure is the least intrusive available measure.
Thank you. If I can move on to Alex Rowley, please.
And good morning. I wonder, I noted this analysis or analogy of the military planning for previous wars rather than future wars. I mean, is there evidence that there is a real need for this bill? Because COVID has exposed many things. So in Scotland, for example, health and social care sits in chaos, and the government's not been seen to act on that. But suddenly it comes forward and says, we need this legislation. I mean, what would your take be on that? Has COVID exposed government's inability to actually respond quickly? Is there a need for this legislation, or is it, as many people are putting out, a desperate power grab in order to shift the agenda from the major weaknesses in public services?
Who would you like to direct that to?
My microphone is on, so I'm happy to.
I think Professor Hunter would like to come in. Thank you.
Sorry, that was that R was relating to a previous. I think to a certain extent, the issue, certainly in the English setting, was not so much about lack of legislation but more about preparedness and letting our preparedness slip in recent years. And I think in 2019, the Gates Foundation ranked the UK as being the second best country in the world in terms of preparedness for pandemics. And actually, when it came to it, we weren't. And we weren't because we hadn't maintained the preparedness, we hadn't maintained the stocks of PPE that we should have done. So to a large extent, the legislation that we had in place would have been adequate in my view, but what had failed was our reduced preparedness because we hadn't maintained stocks, we hadn't acted on the results of the findings of the Cygnus exercise, and we hadn't used the coronavirus pandemic plan, we used the influenza pandemic plan in the UK, despite the fact that we had a coronavirus plan written up and on and available. Over.
So in your view, do you believe that this legislation, having looked at it, will lead to the government being better prepared, or is it not so much legislation but actually getting the work done and ensuring that things like PPE etc. are in place? You don't need to legislate for that, I would have thought.
Well, certainly from a public health perspective, I wouldn't, I'd certainly, and again, I can't always speak for Scotland, although I know some aspects of the Scottish legislation, worked with colleagues in Scotland for many years. But to a large extent, I think what failed in the first months of the pandemic was not a failure of legislation. It was a failure of preparedness that we were already obliged to have undertaken. Over.
I wonder if any of the other members of the panel, in terms of this question, the actual need for this legislation. I wonder if
yes, I'll come in on that, Mr. Rowley. Thank you. I mean, I think one thing to note, and just to build on what Professor Hunter said, is that what Schedule 19 of the Coronavirus Act effectively does, which is what this part of this bill builds on, is to level up public health powers in Scotland compared to the Public Health Act that applied, that the Westminster government had available to it. Similarly, other schedules do the same, as you know, for Northern Ireland and for Wales. So as a general matter, if one considers that powers of this kind are necessary and useful should there be a public health emergency, then my understanding is that some kind of legislative provision is required because the Coronavirus Act Schedule 19 will expire, as you know. So there's that part to it. And that is the second part of my response, I think, is to say that one of the benefits this Parliament now has is that it can make a set of legislation looking forward to potential future public health emergencies outside of the context of a public health emergency. In other words, without the pressures of urgency and time and exigency that are experienced by parliaments when they have an emergency right before them. And of course, that was the context in which the Coronavirus Act itself was passed. So one question the committee might want to consider is whether or not it is appropriate to take Schedule 19 as the kind of blueprint for this part of the bill, given that it was introduced in an emergency setting, albeit that it mirrors powers from the Public Health Act in England that themselves are very long, long standing. And the third point, I can't speak to the political dimension to which I think you invite us to respond, but I will just say that there will be multiple strands of preparation for any kind of emergency or exigency. Some are resource related, some are planning related, some are logistical, but some are legal. And this is about addressing a legal, getting ready to have a legal framework available should it be needed or not. So the activities can be are divisible in that way. Let's say the fact that a government does this does not necessarily mean they're not involved in doing other things or ought not to be.
I'll just leave it there. Thanks.
Great. Thank you very much. Can I bring in Jim Fairley, please?
Yeah, thank you. You've already given us a huge amount to think about. I'm just trying to go back to something that Mr. Laura said. Yeah, the bit where you're talking about forcing people to have a medical intervention, can you clarify what that actually means, please? Fiona?
Me?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, so I'm looking here, if I understood correctly what we were referring to, at proposed section 86E of the bill, special restrictions and requirements, which includes, if you look at 21A, for example, submission to medical examination, or 21E to be disinfected or decontaminated, or sub-H have their health monitored and the results are reported. There are some things, of course, that can't be required, as you know, under the bill, but those are special restrictions and requirements that are possible, but subject to a higher level of threshold for triggering that power, and that is contained in proposed 86C2, that they are made in response to a serious and imminent threat to public health.
So, and for a layman like myself, that would immediately spring to mind for me. If somebody came into the country who had, for instance, Ebola, they could be required to take medical intervention in order to protect the public. Is that what that means?
Well, within what is contained here in this provision, so to submit to examination, to be removed to hospital, to be kept in quarantine, and so on. So, I mean, you can't, it's expressly excluded in proposed 86D is vaccination or prophylactic treatment. That can never be required through a power under this Act.
Yeah, so the fears of the people who would be opposed to this couldn't say that this Act would allow the government to force you to get a vaccination. But if you come into the country with an infectious disease that we don't have a control for, the government could take action there. Is that a fair assessment of what you're saying?
I think that is a fair assessment of the content of these provisions, but, you know, subject to that caveat that it is actually, you know, there are numerous safeguards built into it that are significant.
Okay, thank you. The second point I just want to pick up, and I'm sorry, I'm jumping about a bit here. I've written spider scribble notes all over the place here. Am I right in thinking of what you're saying is that the preparedness that we had in terms of what the Gates Foundation said in 2019 was UK-wide, and therefore it was more what Westminster was prepared to do, but Scotland didn't have that same legalistic preparedness, and this brings us into line with Westminster. Is that correct?
So I don't think it was referred to by the Gates Foundation. I'm not familiar with that report, but to say that that the part of the Coronavirus Act 2020 passed by Westminster that gave Scottish ministers powers to make public health orders with which you're familiar is Schedule 19. The idea of that was to ensure that the Scottish government and in other schedules, the Northern Irish and Welsh governments had equivalent powers to make these regulations to those enjoyed by the government in Whitehall. And what this bill, in my reading, does is it puts those powers on a permanent footing because the Coronavirus Act in totality is temporary and it will expire.
Okay, that raises another question that I hadn't thought about. If the Coronavirus Act falls, would that then remove all of the Scottish Parliament's ability to make provision in case of another outbreak of an infectious disease?
I'm not an expert in Scottish public health law, but my understanding is that the Public Health etc. Scotland Act of, I think, 2008 does not at this time include these kinds of powers, and that the idea of this bill is to insert them in that Act. If this isn't passed, then the Scottish Parliament, if it wished the government to have similar powers, would need to pass another piece of legislation.
Okay, thank you. So, I'm just trying to gather all my thoughts here. when Alec was talking about preparedness, absolutely we were caught short with PPE and all the rest of it. But does this Act allow that level of preparedness to be put in place at a time when we are not in an emergency? Is that a level of preparedness that we should have on the statute in order to be ready if something else does come along?
So I think there's a danger of conflating multiple things. So things like ensuring you have sufficient stocks of PPE or other forms of medication, you know, almost certainly don't require legislation. So the kind of preparation that this bill in Part 1 seeks to put in place is to say that there is a legal structure there that we can use to introduce restrictions, in essence, that we consider are proportionate and necessary if we are in a situation of a public health emergency. Other things like resourcing, workforce management and so on may be dealt with elsewhere in the bill, and I apologise that I did focus on Part 1, but in any case are unlikely to require, to my knowledge, significant legislative preparation. They're probably more about resource management. But I could be corrected on that.
No, I absolutely take on board what you're saying. I'm just going back to the statement that you made there, that you need multiple strands. To me, this is just another strand that we in this Parliament need to have in preparedness. By all means, we can go back to preparedness in the physical sense, in the healthcare sense, in the hospital sense. We can do all of those things separately. But this is just in a legislative sense, we are preparing ourselves in case of another emergency for the future, that we have the legislative competence to deal with it in this Parliament. Is that
exactly
a fair assessment?
Right. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. Can I move on to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Gina. Good morning to the panel. I'm interested around the potential impact of the legislation, and I'm kind of drawn to looking back over the way in which legislation was initially introduced into Parliament so 2 years ago, and the way in which we responded to coronavirus over that period of time. And it was over an extended period of time. It didn't happen to us suddenly. We watched coronavirus, you know, move across the world from China, across Europe, and into the UK and into Scotland. And I'm wondering what difference it would have made to the way in which we responded to the coronavirus had this legislation actually existed in the first place, because, you know, we actually legislated particularly quickly once the decision was made, or Parliament legislated very, very quickly. And I'm struggling to understand what difference it would have made had this legislation existed in the first place. I think if I could, I would ask Professor Hunter, please, in the first instance.
Yeah, I mean, I think the first thing to say is that a lot of these restrictions generically are, we call, non-pharmaceutical intervention. They're anything from getting people to wear masks, social distancing, isolating patients, border controls. All these things fall within the sphere of NPIs. And I think, you know, we've known for centuries, really, that NPIs never ultimately stop the spread of infectious disease. What they do is delay infections and the spread. And so when you look, and you can see this classically in New Zealand, where at the moment New Zealand has got a higher incidence rate than the UK has, I think, has ever had at the moment, or it's certainly heading that way. And so ultimately all these things failed. The thing though about them is if you delay, you can delay long enough that you can develop, prepare for it, you can develop treatments, you can develop vaccines, and that's what's happened. And that's why, although the UK has had a dreadful mortality rate because of COVID, it could have been a lot worse. So ultimately, they failed. I think the early on, certainly in the English setting, we managed it pretty well in terms of identifying those cases that came into the country and caring for them in secure hospital isolation. clearly, once you've got more than a certain number of infections, though, that sort of control fails and breaks down. And we went into the setting that we had. But yeah, I think the value is not so much in stopping the pandemic, because ultimately that's going to happen anyway. It's delaying it to the point that you can actually reduce the disease burden, reduce mortality, and reduce the pressure on the health services.
I think the question is, Professor Hunter, is what difference would having this legislation have made to the impact and the decisions that were made during that period of time?
Well, it would not have ultimately stopped the pandemic. In the UK, I think one of the difficulties that we've had in the UK is that the four different nations have been doing quite different things, and ultimately, you know, in that sort of context, the spread in one of the four devolved nations is always going to be the impact on the other nations, whatever anybody does. And that's not just a UK criticism, that's a criticism, you know, same thing happened in Germany, same thing happened across Europe as a whole. And so I think that if any legislation needs to be around actually trying to do the right thing across the UK and not just in one country compared to another, because ultimately restrictions in one country aren't going to ultimately have much of an impact. And I think certainly some of these restrictions in place could well have delayed the initial peaks of infection, so that giving people more time to prepare health services, more time to towards getting better treatments. But ultimately, the pandemic would have hit us anyway.
If I can, I'm going to move on to Professor de Londres, if I could. But just layering on top of that, would it not be if we understand the legislation that's required during a pandemic, would it not be more appropriate for that legislation to lie dormant with potential to be resurrected by Parliament very quickly, as we've done in the past? Should such a pandemic come along, Professor de Londres?
I'm just waiting. Again, we can distinguish between two different sets of legal measures, right, that are needed here. So first of all, you need legislation that empowers the government to make restrictions. This is this kind of legislation. And then you need the restrictions or the regulations in order to try to address the public health emergency as it exists at a particular time. And that's what you would introduce under these. So in some ways, you could argue that, yes, the entire Act or this part of the Act could be dormant and be debated now and then promulgated or commenced if there is a public health emergency. That would be one way of doing it. It's not clear that it adds a huge amount in terms of process or rigour, right, to do that with the broad enabling legislative framework. What is interesting to think about is whether or not it would be possible to look at the types of restrictions that may be required and to try to model out, for example, different levels of restriction, lockdowns, partial lockdowns, public health restrictions, education restrictions, and so on, and to have almost a kind of a set of templates or potential drafts for different levels of regulation that could be introduced, which the Parliament could debate and scrutinise and might then be triggered by the ministerial, using the ministerial power in the framework legislation in the case of any kind of public health emergency. So you have these two kind of models. One, put it all on ice. You have an example like the Enhanced TPIM Act in Westminster. It's been on ice since 2011, ready to be used or commenced if needed. or you can introduce the legislation but try to predict different levels of regulation that might be introduced. You'd have to leave the space for flexibility, you know, for responsiveness to the realities of a pandemic as they existed on the ground, but you could have a general sense that schools or public institutions could plan for, you know, to know that you have three levels, let's say, full lockdown, partial lockdown, no lockdown, whatever, in different institutions, and they could plan around that. So that is an option. It doesn't seem to have been foreseen or considered as an alternative approach based on the policy memorandum. But even if you pass this bill, you could still think about maybe developing a set of potential regulations or tiers or approaches that would be available as a kind of blueprint or starting point in the event of an emergency in the future.
Thank you. If I bring in Anthony Smith here just for my final point, I think one of the concerns here is that the impact of COVID restrictions on non-COVID health issues are still being collated. I wonder what your thoughts are on the impact of bringing legislation like this in before we can take that judgment. I think the word, you know, require the Scottish ministers bringing in restrictions require a proportionate. I would suggest that is subjective, and in doing so, there's no need to seek any advice. As an example, this idea of being submitted to some medical interventions, albeit that it be maybe a higher threshold, is still subjective, and these decisions can be made by Scottish ministers. I wonder if you would comment on that, Mr. Smith.
Thank you. I think my expertise that I can bring on this is not so much on that specific issue, but about the general point that there has to be a political judgment about the balance in public health measures. But when those judgments are being taken in the midst of an emergency, it is far more likely that there will be greater risk of overreach and an inability of the public debate to be properly heard. And that's what we saw during the pandemic in a range of countries around the world, that measures were brought in without proper consideration. So I think the only comment I could make about this particular process is that there is a potential benefit of being able to have that debate properly in a non-emergency time to really consider what we learned from the experiences both in Scotland and other countries about the type of measures that were appropriate and their impact on rights of individuals and other public policy priorities.
Thank you. Can we move on to Mason, please?
Thanks so much, convener. Maybe if I can stick with Mr. Smith on the issue of kind of scrutiny. I mean, I'm still really trying to get my head around what should be in primary legislation and what should be in secondary legislation. So, I mean, would it be your argument that it's easier and generally scrutiny of primary education, primary legislation is better than of secondary legislation?
I don't think that's necessarily our experience, except that parliaments in primary legislation tend to include the possibility of closed legislative scrutiny more frequently, and that it is more likely that secondary legislation will be less subject to closed legislative scrutiny, which can go back and test whether or not the provisions are being implemented properly, whether they achieve the objectives that they have. But the secondary legislation, there's a greater risk that it's not reviewed as effectively and as deeply. But that can also happen with primary legislation. You need to make sure that you put the right provisions in that are clear, that set a time scale for that review and that enable the review to be done thoroughly.
But the very fact that we're spending longer on this piece of legislation as primary legislation, and I mean, your paper on a post-legislative scrutiny is very critical of parliaments generally, and we are one of them that are guilty of not going back and looking at legislation enough. And also the whole point around made affirmative that things were being rushed in. So, I mean, it seems to me you're going to get better legislation, are you not, if you've spent more time over it, you've thought about it, and then you give it a proper review. Whereas anything that's rushed in at the last minute is inevitably, you know, going to be weaker.
Exactly. Yes.
Okay, I mean, I don't know if either the other two want to comment on these kind of points. Is primary legislation, you know, more solid? Is it more dependable than secondary legislation?
I think Professor DeLondres wants to come in.
Professor DeLondres, right?
Yes, so I think in a way it goes back to the preliminary comment you made, Mr. Mason, about what goes into primary and what goes into secondary legislation, right? So certainly primary legislation made in a non-emergency context and subject to a robust legislative procedure such as this one will have a higher level of scrutiny than, for example, a regulation made using the made affirmative procedure. But the point is that there needs to be a balance. So the primary legislation provides the framework through which the secondary legislation, as you know, can be made. And, you know, the thing is that you have to leave some space in secondary legislation for things that you couldn't foresee at the time of primary legislation, because the secondary legislation has to respond to the concrete realities of a particular situation that cannot be foreseen in an abstract situation like this. So the question becomes then, what can you do in the primary legislation to try to ensure an appropriate level of scrutiny of the secondary legislation, you know, going forward? And here I think, you know, there are a couple of things in this bill that maybe you might want to explore further on this. So, for example, the default position under the bill is that regulations would be made using the affirmative procedure, but the usual capacity to use the made affirmative procedure in a situation where a Scottish minister considers it's urgently required remains. Now, we know that over the pandemic, the made affirmative procedure has been used with unprecedented frequency in Scotland. And often, or not often, but at least sometimes, in situations where it's not at all clear that there is an urgent need, like that no other mode of making the secondary legislation was possible, more scrutiny heavy mode of making it. So the question is there anything you can do there to up that threshold of urgency? Like, for example, requiring a ministerial statement to explain why they consider it is urgently required, rather than something that could be done using the affirmative procedure. We also have a very welcome provision in the bill that all regulations introduced would be reviewed. And I think that is very welcome. That's proposed section 86G. And they should be reviewed every 3 weeks. But the bill doesn't actually say, you know, what should happen to the review? Does it need to be published? Does a parliamentary committee have to consider it? The review is supposed to inform whether it would be continued, right? So if it's simply a ministerial review that is not actually scrutinised by Parliament, is it useful in terms of ensuring there is robustness and rigour throughout the process? And the last point I'll make, just to flag it in case we get through this without mentioning it, is that the proposed section 86FD that would go into the Public Health Act would allow a Scottish minister to make a regulation under these powers that could modify any enactment, including this act. That's an extremely wide Henry VIII power they're known as. I cannot see where it came from. It doesn't seem to be in the equivalent provisions of Schedule 19 of the Coronavirus Act. And while it's mentioned in the explanatory notes, it's not explained. And of course, that's a hugely, can you imagine a power like that being used with the made affirmative procedure? That would be extremely concerning. I think that's something perhaps to press in terms of figuring out how the scrutiny through the primary legislation could be enhanced for the justified and necessary use of secondary legislation in the future. Sorry, that was very long.
Okay, no, that was helpful. I think when you refer to 86, if I'm not mistaken, that's in the 2008 Act, which is now being amended in this bill. And I suppose, you know, use the word balance, which is exactly a word that was in my mind. You know, from what you know of the 2008 Act, did it get the balance wrong? Was there not enough in it?
I'm sorry to say that I don't know. I'm not familiar with, sufficiently familiar with that Act to give a view on it. Sorry.
No, that's okay. We've not heard from, Professor Hunter, yes. Did you want to say anything on this point?
Yeah, I would just say, I mean, I think looking at some of the, there's a difference in terminology in terms of what we class as a medical intervention. 86E, I don't think any, there's a difference between getting people to have antibiotic treatment for, say, multidrug-resistant tuberculosis than getting, and certainly that is excluded from the Act, and I think that's right, and I don't think we can do that in the UK. But a lot of the requirements under 86E are things that actually in England are already we can do, you know, and it's very rare to use these powers. But for example, in my own career, seen people with multidrug-resistant tuberculosis be required to be relocated in a healthcare establishment because of the risk that they pose to spreading a very difficult, very serious disease to people in the local pubs and that sort of thing. So a lot of what is in there is things that we already have available. And I think some of these issues as well, I mean, if you've got a Ebola patient coming into the UK, into Scotland, flying into Glasgow, and then they have clearly got Ebola, but they don't want to stay in hospital. What are the powers in Scotland at the moment regarding that? Because if you release them, that could be... and so it seems to me that some of these, if they're not available to you, there is an argument to have those powers available.
I mean, if I can just push you finally on that one point to finish. I mean, if some powers are specific for Ebola and some powers are specific for TB, should we not leave them till the situation arises and have them in the secondary legislation then?
Well, I think that with Ebola, you know, why do you need second legislation until you get cases? And the issue about Ebola, if you've got a patient who flies into Glasgow and then wants to self-discharge from hospital, that's not going to give time for secondary legislation to be enacted, is it? If that power doesn't, if maintaining them in hospital isn't already a power that you have in Scotland, and I don't know, you know, listening to the other speakers talking, that may not be a power that you actually have at the moment. But if it isn't, then you do need to have some thought about how you could actually deal with that situation.
Okay, thanks. That's very helpful. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We've just got a couple more minutes. Can I bring in Murdo Fraser, please?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener. I wonder if I could go back to Professor de Londres and just explore a little bit further an issue that we touched on earlier, which is this question of the use of the made affirmative procedure, which is covered quite in detail in the written evidence you've given. And you know, you're clearly quite critical of the use or the overuse of made affirmative procedure. From a practical point of view, if you were going to amend the bill in front of us in order to reduce the reliance on made affirmative procedure, how could you do that to achieve the objective that clearly you want to achieve?
That's a very good question. I mean, I think there are two pathways. One is to change the threshold by which the made affirmative procedure can be used, which at present is the Scottish Minister's determination of urgency. It strikes me as not necessarily very desirable to change that, because, of course, the MAP is designed to enable lawmaking in a situation of urgency. So let's say you leave the threshold, then it becomes about the procedure. And I guess, although it is in some ways will appear rather weak or proceduralized, the thing to do would be to require justification of the claim of urgency, either through a statement, a ministerial statement, or perhaps otherwise. You have to find the right balance, so you cannot over-proceduralize or over-bureaucratize this, because of course it is about being able to respond quickly. But at least to say that a statement justifying why this must be done using the map to Parliament that can be challenged, you know, would be useful. You'd have seen in our evidence that the SSIs that have been made using this procedure have largely not been subjected to debate in the House. They've been voted through in the chamber, I should say. But where they have been, it's been in response to like a disagreement or somebody expressing concern. The point would be to try to create situations where if there is concern, there's a prompt to express it that would then lead to a question of justification. And through that, to try to ensure that self-restraint is used by the executive in terms of availing of the made affirmative procedure.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I thank the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Good morning. We will now continue to take evidence on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. The focus on this second evidence session will be on bankruptcy measures contained in Part 3 of the Bill. I would like to welcome to our second panel to the meeting is Abby Fleming from Policy and Communications Lead from Money Advice Scotland, Jamie McNeill, Money Matters Advice Service and Social Work Resources at South Lanarkshire Council, Emerita Professor Donna W. McKenzie Skeen, School of Law at University of Aberdeen, and David Mingus, Director of Practice, Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland. A warm welcome and thank you for giving us your time this morning. Each member will have approximately 8 minutes to speak on to this panel and ask their questions. If you'd like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we will try and bring you in. I must apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of brevity. As all our witnesses are remote this morning, can I just ask yourselves to introduce yourself to our members. Could we start with Abby Fleming, please?
Hi, good morning. I'm Abby Fleming and I'm Policy and Communications Lead at Money Advice Scotland. Money Advice Scotland is a membership organisation and we work to support money advisors secure fair policy for people in debt and improve financial wellbeing in Scotland. Thank you for having me along this morning.
Thank you, Abby. Can I bring in Jamie McNeill?
Morning, convening members of the committee. Thank you for having me. My name is Jamie McNeill. I work for South Lanarkshire Council. I work as both a money vice manager and both as a money advisor. I'm hoping today to describe any sort of practical challenges that as a money advisor and as a money vice manager was that we're currently having at the moment. Thank you for having me.
Thank you very much, Jamie. And can I bring in Emerita Professor Donna W. McKenzie Skeen. I think we've got a signal problem.
Thank you for having me along to the committee. I have recently been early retirement. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can. Yes, we can. I'm sorry, I think we're having a few problems with yourself. We'll just move on to David Mingus, please.
Good morning, convener, and good morning to the committee members. I'm David Mingus. I'm the Director of Practice with ICAS, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of Scotland. We authorise and regulate many of the IPs that work in Scotland in the area of bankruptcy. And prior to my present role, I worked as a licensed insolvency practitioner for almost 20 years or so, so have lots of practical experience of the issues that are under discussion today. Thank you for having me.
Thank you very much. I think we still have technical issues with Emerita Professor Donna McKenzie Skeen. I was just going to bring you in just to see if we've resolved those issues.
Yes, I think hopefully I'm on audio only now and that will work. I have recently taken early retirement from the University of Aberdeen, having researched and published in the area of insolvency law, particularly personal insolvency law, for the past 30 years, but I remain active in research. And so I'm delighted to make a contribution to the committee today.
Brilliant. Thank you very much and a warm welcome. If we could just move to questions and if I may begin, the first one I'm going to ask the panel about is the proposed bankruptcy threshold. So the emergency coronavirus legislation increased the debt threshold in which the creditor can make someone bankrupt from 3,000 to 10,000 during the pandemic. Now this bill proposes to set it permanently at £5,000. I would just like the panel's view on the amount of the bankruptcy threshold, if I may. Could I start with Abby Fleming?
Thanks, convener. I think the first point I'd like to make is that although this is a piece of legislation on COVID recovery, I think it's really important to address it in the context of, yes, we're coming out of a pandemic, but we're coming out of a pandemic into a cost of living crisis. And I don't think that I don't think the legislation can be taken without considering that fact. We at Money Advice Scotland do agree that there is a need for a permanent increase from £3,000 However, we are unsure if 5,000 in the context of the long-lasting effects of COVID and the likely long-lasting cost of living crisis will be sufficient. So we're of the view that £5,000 may be too low at this point. Scottish Government has indicated plans to extend the current £10,000 level, and we believe this is the correct approach. However, as this will only be a temporary measure and the cost of living crisis is likely to endure for some time, we aren't convinced that £5,000 will be sufficient after that, and maybe £6,000 or £7,000 might be a way to offer better protection for people in debt. Debt not only incurred by the pandemic, but debt that will be incurred or exacerbated by the current cost of living emergency. What we're worried about is that £5,000 may put people at significant risk of bankruptcy who, due to the pandemic and current situation, no longer have or don't have this disposable income to access other debt solutions such as the debt arrangement scheme or a trust deed. And we worry about what might happen to people's assets that they might have wanted to protect by going into something like a DAS. So that would be our main point to raise at this moment. Thank you.
Thank you, Abby. I think you raised some very valid points there with the increase of cost of living. Can we bring in Jamie McNeill, please?
Thank you, convener. Myself and my colleagues do believe that 5,000 is too low. I'm sure everybody here would agree that bankruptcy is the ultimate sanction and therefore should have a proportionate value. If somebody, for instance, had their car repossessed, potentially they could lose their property as a result if they were made bankrupt. With the high cost of living increasing, especially over the last couple of months, was that we do believe that a lot of people are going to be put under severe pressure, was it? And that even if you're not willing to, even the extension was it of 6 months, was it would be good, but we think permanently was it £10,000, was it should be the limit. And that way was it, a lot of people would feel safer, was it when taking out credit, was it because it works both ways. Otherwise, was it potentially somebody taking out a loan for £5,000 is unknowingly potentially putting their house at risk, was it, in the future. Thanks, that's all I've got to say about that.
Thank you, Jamie. Could I bring in Emerita Professor Donna McKenzie-Skene, please?
Convener. As the committee will be aware, there has been an ongoing review of bankruptcy solutions, and I have been chairing Working Group 3, and the current figure which is in the bill corresponds with the figure which Working Group 3 recommended. Now, the recommendation is first finalised at the end of last year, but full of ink.
I'm sorry, we are still having technical issues, however, with your audio.
I do think that there is a question of balance here.
I'm sorry, Emerita Professor Donna McKenzie, I'm going to have to come back to you because you are cutting out because of those technical issues. Apologies for that. If I can bring in David Mingus, please.
Context of the situation, and this really isn't just about coming out of coronavirus. And in actual fact, it's not really just about the cost of living crisis that's going to come about. This is obviously a figure that's going into primary legislation, and therefore, hopefully that should go much longer than any of these relatively short-term crises. I think, however, what this is really about is around balancing the rights of creditors together with the rights of debtors. And this is purely about whether creditors are able to take steps to declare someone bankrupt. I think it's really important to just put it in the overall context, which is of bankruptcies, roughly about 96 to 98% of bankruptcies each year are actually debtor-led. So it is the debtor that is taking that step. Only in approximately 2 to 4% of overall bankruptcies are creditors taking those initial steps. So the number of bankruptcies that this actually affects is very low in overall terms. We're talking probably about, in normal times, you know, somewhere around about 1,000 to 1,200 bankruptcies per year are creditor-led petitions. The vast majority of those are actually made by local authorities on the back of council tax debt and also on HMRC. So a lot of the decisions around this really come back to local authority and government policy on debt recovery. So that has a significant bearing on who is petitioned for bankruptcy. I think it's important to also just mention that, you know, a lot of consumer debt, which is what most individual bankruptcies are relating to, the vast majority of that actually comes from, or the debt that are in those bankruptcies come from financial services. So banks, credit cards, HP, etc. And those are all regulated by the Financial Conduct Authority and FCA guidance, which requires those entities to treat customers fairly and not take those ultimate steps of bankruptcy unless they have already worked through all the other provisions that there can be to get the debt sorted out in the first place. Bankruptcy also is, I guess, never without ultimate warning. You know, debtors will be aware of the issues, the debt that's lying, that's there beforehand, and therefore they have the opportunity to deal with this in advance. So we believe, I think, that in overall terms, the increase from 3,000 to 5,000 is a fair balance. I think we are concerned that, I guess, there is perhaps not enough thought being given at this particular stage in terms of unintended consequences that there might be, and the knock-on effect, for instance, into protected trust deeds. So will the increase of £5,000 debt force more people into trust deeds rather than bankruptcy, or vice versa? And I think, you know, those are just the unintended consequences. I think we're satisfied, I guess, that you're reducing it from 10,000 to 5,000 mitigate some of that risk of those unintended consequences, and therefore, in overall terms, that increase to 5,000 is a fair balance to be struck in overall terms.
Thank you very much, David. I found that very interesting. I wasn't aware of the government and local authorities and the amount of bankruptcies that are initiated by them. Can I move on to Murdo Fraser?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'd like to raise a slightly different issue, which is the question of electronic notification of bankruptcy documents. And I note the bill is proposing to make permanent the temporary provisions that were in the coronavirus legislation to allow electronic notification rather than service in hard copy. I'm interested to know from the panel whether you have any concerns about this being made permanent, and whether there are any practical implications to this. I mean, I just speak from personal experience. I mean, like many of my MSP colleagues, we probably receive hundreds of electronic communications every day. And it's not infrequently that people will say to you, we sent you an email that we didn't receive, either because it's gone into spam or because it's been quarantined, or sometimes just disappeared into the ether. So how reliable is the system of electronic notification, and are there enough safeguards in the bill to protect people from this? Maybe I could start with Abby Fleming.
Thank you very much. So, excuse me, despite our name as Money Advice Scotland, we ourselves don't deliver money advice, so I don't have all of the evidence to comment on the effect on clients rather than others, sorry, than making a sort of general point about the importance of taking account of digital exclusion. A lot of people who are presenting for money advice may not be the most digitally literate and may not have the best access to digital. So I think that's something that, as a wider point, needs to be taken account of. Unfortunately, I can't provide figures or anything like that at the moment. I do think it's important that in the bill, it does seem to build in a safeguard in the sense that the recipient must have indicated to the sender that they are willing to receive these documents and these notifications in a particular way. So I think this should go some way to mitigate against documents being sent electronically when this isn't appropriate for the client. But again, if there's a wide volume of electronic documents being sent, I think it's important to make sure that this isn't overlooked. But That's all I really have to say. I don't have any massive concerns about this provision being made permanent, but I don't deal directly with clients.
Okay, thank you. Maybe thank you very much. Maybe the same question to Jamie McNeill.
Thank you. Yes, we would have concerns. What tends to happen is when somebody goes into debt, they eventually start disconnecting things. So your internet will go first, your telephone will go next, just to keep your gas and electricity on. So although the person may have made the application via online and ticked the box to say, yes, online's great, because that's in those circumstances, that's where they were at that point. At the point of where they're in debt and potentially at a bankruptcy stage, the most likelihood is that they probably won't have that service available and are more likely to miss it. And, you know, obviously the consequences of bankruptcy are too great, was it, for somebody to not have that notification. So we believe, you know, a personal visit by a sheriff's officer or recorded delivery is still the most effective way of communicating a potential bankruptcy or notification of a bankruptcy to somebody.
Okay, thank you. David Minnis.
Yeah, thank you. I think there's lots of different points of delivery, I guess, and lots of different situations throughout the course of a bankruptcy, pre, during and post, where communication is made. And I think it's important perhaps to offer some distinction between some of those. I absolutely take the point from Jamie in terms of the pre-bankruptcy situation or such like, where there can be the difficulties, I guess, of communications being cut off, etc. I think that is a completely different situation from once you're in bankruptcy, and again, also once you're in that bankruptcy, in terms of communicating with the individual who is subject to the bankruptcy and to their creditors. So I think there needs to be some real distinctions made in many of those cases. I think in terms of communication with creditors, from the trustee to the creditors, again, I reflect on my previous comments, which are that many of the main creditors that are involved in consumer bankruptcies are large institutions such as banks, credit cards, local authorities, etc. And certainly they very much prefer electronic communication and I think have robust systems in place. We've had many years of experience through the other personal insolvency regimes where electronic communication is being used, and there are certainly no indications that there are issues with those in those cases. Similarly, we have moved in corporate insolvency very much to electronic communication. That was introduced in England and Wales in 2016 and in Scotland from 2018. And again, you know, there is no evidence to suggest that there have been substantial problems with that in those cases. So I think, you know, there are many advantages. I absolutely take your point about you have experienced situations where you're told emails have been sent and they've not been received. I think we can also equally reflect on that and say, I've certainly had lots of situations where I'm led to believe a letter has been posted to me and it's never been received either. So, you know, electronic communication and old style communication, if you like, there are always risks that things are not received either from the infrastructure or for various other reasons. But I think in broad terms, electronic communication is the way things are going. It's absolutely the way government, I guess, wants to go in terms of a digital first policy. And as I say, from the evidence that we're seeing from the temporary measures and equivalent provisions within corporate insolvency, we're not experiencing many difficulties at any stages, either from the creditors, from the trustees, or from those that are affected by the insolvency themselves.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Minnis. Professor Mackenzie Skeen, get your view on this, please. If we have you. Commissioner.
I think if we continue to have technical issues with Professor... She's there.
Yeah, I am. Sorry, I hadn't been unmuted. I'm not aware of particular practical difficulties which have arisen. I'd very much support everything that David said in relation to the electronic communications issues. I think things occasionally do go missing, whether it's electronic or...
Sorry, you've cut recall. Out again. Sorry, Professor Skeen. I think if we continue to have these technical issues, what we can do is we can send the questions raised from the committee today, and I know that you can respond in writing, but apologies for these technical issues. Okay, can I move on to Alex Rowley?
Thank you, Convener. I think it was David Minnis that said talked about normal times, and I found myself thinking, what is normal times? But it strikes me we had the global economic collapse in 2008. We then had austerity, which had a major impact on public services. And I have a general question that I would like to ask, and it is about the ongoing support that is available for members of the public trying to access money advice, debt services, etc. You know, have we seen a rise? We certainly saw a rise in demand, but have we seen a rise in the numbers of service available? Or I certainly know in my own case in Fife, I think, you know, the local authority made big cuts in those areas. So maybe I could start with Jamie and ask around the provision and the pressure so that people are getting the support and services they need. Jamie.
Thank you, Alex. Yeah, like every agency probably across the country, there was a big change. We were predominantly a face-to-face organisation. People used to walk in, see us, you make appointments, see us, and then all one day it just changed. So like everybody was that we had to change the way we deliver the service. But now we have to communicate mainly by telephone, which has its own practical challenges. You know, a lot of stuff now done by post, sometimes email if the client's able to. So we have provided a service, was it throughout the pandemic? We've adapted as best we can. We're continuing to adapt as we come out the pandemic. Was it we're putting in plans? Was it where we're going to try and maybe hopefully catch the people that we've missed? Because, you know, a lot of people was it we're almost sure of that, you know, we've not seen. The increase in demand for service was it has just continued. Was it, I would say, even since October, was it we've noticed about a 30% increase. You know, it's been huge. Was it law of money advisors just now? Was it and clients? Was it well-being? Obviously, some issue that as a manager was it we're having to look at because of the fact that each client you see was it you do take on a little bit of their stress. And the clients we're seeing just now was it we would call them complex cases. And the reason why we call them complex cases is because it's not normal consumer debt that we've seen in 2008 where people overspent or there's irresponsible lending. Now we're seeing people can't afford to heat their home, can't afford to pay their rent, they can't afford to, you know, feed themselves. Was it so food bank referrals are up, fuel voucher referrals are up. You know, it's just the normal cost of living was it. So the demand we're seeing on service, a lot of people coming to us was there's no quick, easy fix. It's not just a case of, okay, you go bankrupt. Because you go bankrupt, was it for rent, council tax, gas, electricity arrears, that doesn't help. Was it that puts a band-aid on it. Next year you're in the same problem again. So what requires from the money advice point of view is to look at budgeting, look at you know, anything else and sort of maximizing income, which again is delayed, was it because of the fact that if somebody has a disability and they're claiming disability benefits, the DWP has a bit of a backlog with, you know, assessment periods, which means people are taking longer to be awarded disability benefits. So where we would normally, you know, maximize somebody's income and it'd be relatively happening relatively soon, nowadays everything's taking so much longer, was it? So as a resource, was it we find we're managing the best we can, but it is under a lot of pressure just now, was it? And we can only see it increasing. As we say, month on month, was it since October especially, the increase has been really dramatic.
Yeah, thanks,
hopefully
Jamie.
That answers your question.
Yeah, thanks, Jamie. Abby, I mean, the same question, but can I ask, I mean, is there adequate provision out there to support the level of demand for these types of services?
I think funding for the advice sector, the free advice sector, has been a long-standing issue well before COVID. That's something we've raised time again before the pandemic happened. As was already mentioned, advice services have been cut over the years. So that has happened before COVID. Obviously, that has a knock-on effect now when demand has increased. So like Jamie said, advice agencies are trying to meet the needs of their clients as best they can with what provision they have. However, as Jamie mentioned, it's not just that there's more cases, it's that there's more cases and these cases are complex. And advisors are reporting to us that it's actually getting harder to know what to advise clients to do because they are presenting with these complex debts where, as Jamie mentioned, it's things like, I can't keep my home, I'm struggling to afford my essential outgoings, and they just don't have the income or the finances to meet their outgoings. And that makes it very difficult for advisors and makes it much more complex. We conducted some research, which was published in 2020, just as the pandemic began. So it was done in the context of, you know, so-called normal times. And that research found that people will endure significant hardship before they eventually reach a money advisor. So, for example, it wasn't until when we surveyed the respondents, it wasn't until someone received a letter with a court summons or a sheriff officer that they would actually think, okay, this is the point where I need to seek money advice. People would go without a lot of essentials, they would endure significant hardship before they would eventually seek money advice, and that leads to how complex their situation is by the time they actually get in front of someone who can help. So that in turn extends the process. So I'm not sure if that answers your question about provision, that, like I said, funding is an issue that's been going on before COVID, but obviously the how complex cases are that people are presenting with compounds the fact that there's a limited availability of advice services and they're having to spend more time on each client because of the situation that they present in. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Could I ask David, you mentioned earlier about the numbers of bankruptcies that are pursued, for example, by local authorities in terms of council tax debt. But is there something we need to look at there? Because there is a feeling that the local authorities will go after individuals, yet they write off millions of pounds every year that is owed to them by corporates and others. I mean, is the approach of the public sector one that's fair, or is it just that it's easier to go after the individual for small amounts than it is to go after the corporates and the companies?
I think that's a really interesting question. However, I'm not sure that I have the knowledge really to talk about that in much detail. I mean, I think a lot of that is really around public sector financing and how that's done. As I seem to recall, there were some issues around how local authorities treat debt write-offs and the impact that has on their budgeting and such like. But as I say, again, unfortunately, that's not an area that I have an awful lot of knowledge on. So I'm not sure that I can answer much more than that at the moment, I'm afraid.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Can I move on to John Mason, please?
Hey, thanks, Convener. And perhaps I should also declare that I'm a member of ICAS at this point. Professor Skeen kind of mentioned earlier on, I'm not sure if she's available to speak or not, but there is a working group and there's a review going on of wider bankruptcy legislation. And having been on finance and other committees in the past, I know that is quite a complex area. So I suppose my main first question is, should we be touching bankruptcy at all in this bill, or should we be leaving it aside for the review to come along in due course? Professor Skeen, if you are there. Doesn't look like it.
Yet now, there is certainly some merit, I think, in the change of the situation.
Sorry, Professor Skeen.
And I think it's important to bear in mind that this wider review is going on.
We're hearing bits of you, but I'm afraid we're not hearing enough, I don't think. I don't know if any of the other panel members are involved in this process. Mr. Mingus?
also involved in this process, and I've been sitting on the working group that's been dealing with the moratorium and common financial tool side of things. I think in terms of your general question, Mr. Mason, that you know the whether we should be looking at bankruptcy or not at the moment, I think is a good one. But I think I caught Donna saying there that she probably would agree that now is the time to look at it. I would agree with that. Actually, I think you know there are some very easy fixes in some ways. You know, are very so the temporary measures that we brought in through the coronavirus emergency legislation. There are some really good things there that have aided the process in the meantime, and I think are generally uncontroversial. You know, in major terms. Where the wider review is looking at is some of the more controversial areas or the more difficult areas or the more some of the areas which go across multiple areas. And I think that is right to leave those for further stages. But I think the aspects that are included within this bill are probably ones that can be tackled just now. And I think there's a concern, I guess, if those were kicked further down the road, that there would be consequences for individuals and just the way that the process works just now, which are unnecessarily being delayed.
Can you give us any indication, if we didn't do it in this bill, how much longer it might be before the review and so on carries on?
From my understanding, I think all the working groups have now drafted their initial reports, and that should be with ministers imminently, as far as I understand. I guess, obviously, beyond that, that is clearly then down to ministers and parliamentary time as to how that can be looked at. I think it's also important to say that I think, again, these are still very much short-term measures which can be fixed or that we're looking at. You'll be aware that ICAS has called for many years for a much wider review of bankruptcy in overall terms, and that's known as the stage three review, which ministers have committed to. But I think that will be many years down the line, where much of the bigger issues can really be looked at in some detail.
Well, thanks. That's very helpful. If nobody else is jumping in on that point, I'll just go on to one other point I had, which would be on moratorium on diligence. Now, as I understand it, that used to be 6 weeks and was extended to 6 months in the emergency. And so the question is, do we go back to 6 weeks? Do we stay at 6 months? Although I think the suggestion was that if we stay at 6 months, some clients might kind of disengage from the process. So I don't particularly mind, but maybe I could start with Mr. McNeill on that one.
Thanks, John. We had a discussion, big discussion yesterday with all our money advisors, and they see it as a very useful tool. We did think from the other side, you know, there was a concern, was it, do people disengage? Was it, if they're told 6 months, you'll be absolutely fine, but we never tell people that. What the 6 months does, it allows people who have found themselves getting into debt, especially nowadays, through no fault of their own, a lot of time, you know, they may have been on furlough, they may have been off sick, they may have lost their job, the increased cost in living. And in the world today, there's so much uncertainty. When they come to Money Advice, was it they want a little bit of certainty, just a wee bit of breathing space, that's all it is. 6 months may seem excessive in some cases, but the average bankruptcy, the average DAS that we do, probably takes 12 weeks if everything goes to plan. By that, I mean the client can provide all the information that was required because they are statutory solutions. So what we would suggest is extending the 6 months, was it, till September, which I think is allowable. And then after that point, doing a review and potentially maybe looking at the 12 weeks. But I think there is some consultation going on just now about moratoriums. But what we feel at the moment, as we're coming out of pandemic, now is too early. There's so much uncertainty in the world. People are, their mental well-being, if you imagine, was after 2 years of being in the pandemic, and now you look, turn on the news, and there's no good news just now. Prices are going up, potential wars everywhere, you know. So,
okay, so I think, so in summary, you're saying stick to the 6 months just now and then maybe 12 weeks later on. Ms. Fleming, would you go down the same route?
Yeah, I would agree with what's been said there. I think 6 months has given clients a bit of breathing space, as Jamie mentioned. I think what the long-term moratorium period is should be, you know, we need to consider, as Jamie mentioned, how long it takes someone to get through that process, because if it's 6 weeks to get through the money advice process, then a 6 week moratorium period is far too short. The one of the aims of the moratorium is so that someone has appropriate time to seek advice. So we need to make sure that it's realistic in terms of how long that takes, and some of the points that have been raised as to why that is now taking longer need to be considered when deciding what the long-term moratorium period would be. So at Money Advice Scotland, we're of the view that it should not be any shorter than 12 weeks. I'm also part of the working group that is looking at moratorium, and I thought it might be useful just to share some of the discussion that's coming out in there in terms of longer term suggestions for moratoriums.
I think we're a little bit pushed for time, but any quick comment you could make on it, yes?
Yeah, just the suggestion that it might be useful longer term for advisors to be able to apply for an extension to that moratorium should extraneous circumstances come up. So that might be something that could be considered. However, that's been, as I said, dealt with in the working group, but just to make you aware. Thank you.
Okay, and I think I've used my time, but Mr. Mingus wanted back in just very quickly.
Yeah, I was just going to say, again, this is something that the working group has been looked at. I think, if I'm correctly stating, that the bill doesn't actually deal with the moratorium at all. There are no provisions within it at this stage, albeit I understand that perhaps the government are looking to introduce something at stage two of the bill. Is the indication on that. I think just going back to Abby's comments, just in relation to where the working group is sat on this at the moment, I think it's fair to say there was no consensus as to what that period should be. You know, I think that there are wider considerations that need to be taken into account. Some of the discussions that we had was really around creditors, which are typically UK-wide creditors rather than necessarily Scottish creditors. There's the impact of the debt relief scheme down in England and Wales, where their equivalent moratorium breathing space period is 60 days. I think there was concern that 60 days was perhaps it's more than the 6 weeks, but perhaps reflecting back on some of the comments around access to money advice generally, you know, is that still going to be enough? And I think there was a feeling that perhaps 60 days might be a good starting point, but perhaps with the ability for money advisors to apply for an extension to take it up to 90 days.
I'm sorry, I think we're going to have to leave it at that. But maybe if there is an amendment, witnesses might like to write in and with their comments on that. Thanks.
Can I move to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you. I'll be brief. I think my interest really lies around the impact of COVID. I mean, pre-COVID, both business and personal debt, you know, was being, you know, obviously it was being managed, and also the impact of COVID has put an awful lot of a strain on that. And I know we're talking about here about potentially having time for a moratorium that allows people to get back onto an even keel. But in the end, bankruptcy is about trading insolvent. So how do we square that circle in that respect if we're going to, you know, just allowing people a bit more time to get back on an even keel, but they may be potentially trading insolvent during that period of time? And could I ask David Mingus, please?
Yeah, I think that is a really difficult question to deal with. I think, again, just to be clear, the moratorium will not resolve those issues. You know, this is very much around a very short period of time for somebody to access appropriate advice in those circumstances. I think, as both Jamie and Abby have said earlier on, you know, there is a distinction to be made, I think, between money advice and debt advice. Money advice very much being around how can we look at your future going forward, your income, your expenditure, as well as the debt position. You know, and I think there are different solutions that need to be looked at as part of that. I think that is part of the what I referred to earlier on as the stage three bankruptcy review, which is actually we need to take a much wider and more fundamental view of some of those issues to come up with a solution for the modern working day.
Just finally on that point, the 5K limit aside, which has been discussed and perhaps suggested is too low, is there anything within the bill that should be considered to deal with the issue I spoke about before, that time to try and change the way in which COVID has impacted on debt? I'll ask David Mingus again, please.
Yeah, again, I mean, I don't believe that necessarily COVID itself has impacted on debt significantly. I think that, you know, the biggest issues at the moment is really around the cost of living crisis, you know, and that element around many people just not having enough income to deal with the expenditure, you know, the rising fuel costs, etc. You know, these are not debt issues. These are much wider issues which impact on you know, social care funding and all sorts of other issues as well. So, you know, again, you know, this is not really about debt issues in this particular circumstance.
Yeah. So, unless anybody else has a comment to make, I'm happy to leave it there, Convener.
Thank you. Can I move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, Convener. One of the things that struck me about this is that we're talking very much in broad terms about debt and all the rest of it. The bit that strikes me is one of the most significant strains on anybody's mental well-being is debt, and it's a massive thing. And we're talking in very abstract terms about the power to serve documents to a bankruptcy process electronically or by post and all the rest of it, and it's all very abstract, but I think we should keep it in our heads that this is about people and what they're living through. I think we've probably covered whether it should be electronic or by post. We've also covered the power to hold meetings remotely or in a physical location. Those things are the purpose of what's coming in this bill. But I just want to get a general sense of how you feel people are coping with their debt right now, given the circumstances that we're living in. Abby, can I come to you first?
Thank you. Again, I don't deal directly with clients, but the anecdotal evidence that we are getting from our members and those in our network is that, as you said, debt and the pandemic have been our two major stressors on mental health. And when you combine the two, I think there's a bit of a sense of hopelessness from people, because advisors are reporting, as has already been mentioned, it's not that someone's in debt yet and they need a debt solution, it's that they are not able to afford their costs, and whether that's because they've had an income shock because of the pandemic and that's now been exacerbated by the current cost of living crisis. I think there's the sense that people just don't really know what to do, and that's trickling down into the advice community as well. It's very hard for advisors to tell people you can make a saving here or you can switch to this and you can have more income or have more disposable income when we're in a cost of living crisis where those sort of things just really aren't possible and any savings may be marginal. So I think someone in a meeting a few weeks ago described it as people just have too much month left at the end of the money. And that's the sense that we're getting. Thank you.
I'm going to just go on that very quickly. What the cost of living crisis, people getting into debt, what causes people to get into debt in the first place? Because I remember the debates going around people charging interest at 2,500%, et cetera, et cetera, these short-term loan companies. Are we going to see a prevalence of that kind of direction, that people who are struggling to cover their cost of living, is that the direction that they're going to go? Jamie, what do you think of that?
Hi there. What we found recently, probably in the last six to 12 months, was that a lot of family members are borrowing from each other. So you borrow, then they help you pay back. And so there's a lot of sort of family support, if you have a family support network with it. So we kind of find a lot of people are doing that on their bank statements. You can see a lot of money passing to and from. The main trouble is it doesn't solve the problem. It only alleviates it for that 1 week, that 2 days, that, you know, where somebody needs a top up for their gas, electricity. what drives people into debt isn't the high interest rates, it's the fact that now their income is taken up with rent, council tax, gas, electricity. Food is kind of that's kind of a fourth priority sometimes for people. But as soon as you start increasing the gas, electricity, I suppose, is the biggest one we're seeing at the moment. But as soon as you start increasing that, was it everything else, you know, because people need to heat their house, you know, have their electricity on. And so they start cutting back on other things. So they stop paying their debt, they stop paying their council tax, they even stop paying the rent because they think, well, my gas is an immediate need that I have right now, whereas my rent, fair enough, it'll take me to court, was it, but it'll probably be a couple of months away, was it? And that's the sort of the experience that we're having with clients, that they're having to self-prioritize what's important for them, as opposed to, you know, it could be easy for us to say, no, your rent's really important, your council tax really important. But for them, the immediate fact is that I'm cold. You know, I'm sitting here freezing. I need to put my heating on. I either choose my heating or my rent. What am I going to pay? Or I'm going to feed my kids. You know, so it's the immediateness of the. And when people come to us, as I was saying before, different when it was like consumer debt and you could just, you know, manage that and you can move it away. But now it's not. It's like you phone your gas electricity company, was it, and you missed a couple of payments. They don't want to, their repayment plan is that it's built into your actual ongoing direct debit. So they'll say to you, you owe £600, we'll divide that by 12, we'll add it on to your increased cost you have already. So now you're going to be paying us £300 a month. Yeah. People are going to say, well, I can't pay £300 a month for my gas and electricity. I couldn't pay £150, I couldn't pay £100. But how are you expecting me to pay £300? Yeah. So as a result, it has a knock-on effect of everybody else's disposable income that's taken up just by living. That's all it is. People were just managing before, no longer managing. I think the poverty bar you probably find has now increased. Was it to such a level? Was it that?
So in terms of the legislation that we're looking at just now, I fully take right, on board all of the stuff that you're talking about, and it's why I made the comment right at the start. But in terms of what we're looking at just now, David, how is this going to help the situation that we find ourselves in right now? Abby, I will come back to you very briefly at the end of what David's got to say.
I think the issue, or part of the issue, is in relation to actually understanding what it is or how the route out is to be taken. And I think that's quite a difficult one. I think there is often a messaging that comes across, which is, actually, let's work your way out of this. Let's see if we can find a solution. Let's pay things off over a longer period of time. Let's move you into the debt advice scheme or something like that. Actually, I think sometimes, you know, actually the best solution will be to actually deal with the debt that has built up. That then allows some of the cash that's coming in on a monthly basis to be released to service ongoing a new expenditure that's been caused. So I think in some ways there needs to be a change from Scottish Government in terms of saying, actually, sometimes bankruptcy is the right solution. It's not, you know, it can be okay to go bankrupt. You know, some of those individuals, but the vast majority of individuals that enter into bankruptcy have no assets. So, you know, they don't have much to lose in terms of physical stuff to lose, if you like. Yes, it will absolutely potentially affect credit ratings going forward. But again, you know, some of their credit ratings are shot in any case. And therefore, actually, sometimes bankruptcy might well be the best solution to absolutely take away that debt and allow some of that money, which is previously servicing the debt, be used to deal with day-to-day expenditure.
Okay, thanks, David. Abby, I know you wanted to come in very quickly. We're getting short of time.
Yeah, it was just to touch on the points that have been made by Jamie, just to say people, you know, don't get into debt because they're spending too much. They get into debt because they're not able to spend enough. And in the order of prioritisation, council tax normally falls at the bottom, which is why, going back to David's point earlier, the majority of creditor petitions are local authorities, because that is the debt that, or the payment that's seen as the one that can be sort of put at the bottom of the priority list under food and heating and living expenses. In terms of what this bill does to address that, I think this bill is obviously in the context of the provisions that have been put in for COVID, but there are much wider issues that come into play here. So with David's point about people coming into bankruptcy, they don't have a lot of assets. I think what we're worried about is that might start to the people who do have a home, who do have assets they want to protect, may not, as the result of cost of living and COVID, be able to access a solution that might better protect their assets. So that's a slight concern or a major concern for us.
Okay, that's a good
but we don't know how that'll play out yet. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We actually do have a little bit of time because we're going to 11:30. But if I may, I just want your views really, and this could actually be covered under the ongoing bankruptcy review, but our committee did receive a submission this week that I thought was quite interesting that I wanted to raise. So in light of the cost of living crisis, and we've got families say that have been made bankrupt and their wages have been arrested and their bank accounts have been arrested as well. The person that got in touch with us did raise a valid point that people who are struggling financially and also questioned if this bill could be an opportunity to provide people with increased protection from bank account arrestments. We were told that bank account arrestments leaves families with a minimum of £529 in their bank account, regardless if you're single or if you're a couple with three or four kids. And we were sent examples for one family had two children and a mum and dad, and they were left, their bank account was arrested, and they were left with £529 for the rest of the month to survive, and they had to choose between food and gas, electricity and travel and childcare costs that month. Do you think there's an opportunity here that there could be an amendment to the Debtors Scotland Act 1987 to increase the amount that people are left with in their bank accounts from £529, say, for example, to 1,000? I just wanted the panel's views on that. Maybe, Abby, if we start with you.
Yeah, absolutely. I think an increase would be much needed. And obviously this ties into the discussions about moratorium, because while someone's in a moratorium, they are protected. But, like has already been mentioned, the moratorium doesn't necessarily solve the problem. So I think, yes, it would be very useful, and we would be really keen for something like that to be built in. Although then we start looking at whether this becomes a sort of longer term thing and whether some of that might have already been covered in some of the working groups, I'm not sure. But short answer, yes, I think that is absolutely something that needs to be looked at.
Thanks, Abby. Jamie, can I get your thoughts on that?
Well, I'll keep my answer short. Yes, I agree. £1,000 would be appropriate. The main reason being that it leaves people in destitute. They can't get to work. They can't pay for general things, food, etc. So yes, £1,000 would be more appropriate. I agree with the submission.
Thank you very much. And David, I'll bring you in.
Yeah, again, this is not an area that I have a particular expertise in, but you know, I think just looking at the general concept of what we want to do for society, I would agree. I think, you know, just generally an increase between £500 and £1,000, frankly, is probably neither here nor there to most creditors at the end of the day. I think the one thing I would say or just highlight is I know that the accountant in bankruptcy have been looking at diligence in general, and there has been a long going working group looking at that. And again, I think that report is nearing completion, so should be with ministers relatively shortly, or at least I think certainly ministers would be able to be briefed on where the working group has got to with that relatively easily.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. And I thank all the witnesses for your evidence and giving us your time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you on how to do that. The committee's next meeting will be on the 10th of March, where we will continue to take evidence on the bill and our inquiry into excess deaths in Scotland since the start of the pandemic. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and move the meeting into private. Thank you.